Okay. My name is Gatien. I'm a fourth year medical student, and I will present you my work about myocarditis. I try to predict cardiological events in this rare disease of the heart. Let me introduce what is myocarditis. It's an inflammatory pathology of myocardium, which is not an infarctus, but there is an initial attack by an infectious agent like a virus or a bacteria. But this is not the real problem. The real problem is that there is an overreaction of the patient's own immune system. The immune system will attack the heart cells of the patient, and that will destroy many things in the heart and causes the problems. It's a rare disease. There are only 22 cases for 100,000 patient years, and this is a disease of young men with a median age of 30 to 45 years, and the patients are men in 60 to 80 percent of the case. It's also characterized by high polymorphism with various etiologies, various clinical presentation, and various prognoses. And we don't know yet how to what is the link between all of these characteristics. Considering the diagnosis, the gold standard is the biopsy, but since it's it does it have a, it has a high polymorphism, we won't do a biopsy for a patient who is going well. The biopsy is very is less used, and we make MRIs, we make magnetic resonance imaging, which is less invasive. Considering so there are four forms of histology. It consists in the cells, which cells attacks the heart. So there are lymphocytic infiltrate, eosinophils infiltrate, giant cells, and granulomatous tooth. And so there are different prognoses for all these forms. For example, if you have a giant cells myocarditis, you have a one chance 0.50% chance to die. The etiology now, it's very large. It can be a virus, bacteria, toxic like cocaine, some parasites, and some immune disease. As I said, we don't know really much what is the prognosis for all of this form of histology and for all of this etiology, neither. There are three presentation for our patient, three clinical presentation. The pseudo-ischemic presentation, which looks like an infarctus. So basically, it's a man who have a chest pain, but the left ventricle is normal, so the heart is going well, and there is no infarctus. There is also the patient who will come for left ventricle dysfunction and then heart failure, and then the worst, the fulminant presentation with the way of conduction of electrical conduction, which are destroyed by the myocarditis, with an atrioventricular block and arrhythmia. So this is the worst presentation, the fulminant. You have to be in hospital yet, huh? Okay. And then I have to insist, we don't know really much the links between all of this histology, etiology, presentation, prognosis. It's not well known, and that's a problem. And it's because it's a rare disease. For example, I have in my database 359 patients. And this is the second world biggest database in this disease. So there are not a high number of patients. Considering the diagnostic, it's made with MRI. So you see here, there is an infiltrate of human cells. It's a proven myocarditis, and at the electrocardiogram you see there is a segment here. I don't know if you see my mouse, but there is a segment here. It's too high, and it's a scene who looks like an infarctus, but the artery of the heart are normal, so it's a myocarditis. What are the treatment of this disease? At short term, it's antivirals or antibiotics treatment, considering the affection, the primary affection, and it consists on immunosuppressor and anti-inflammatory drugs. Because the main problem is that the body attacks itself. And if for the worst case, we can do a mechanical support and an heart transplant. And then for the long term, we can keep the anti-inflammatory drugs and put some other drugs for heart failure. To fight the heart failure, to help the heart to contract well. And there is the stopping. Actually, it's a disease. When you had it once, you can have it again, mostly doing some sports. So the patients, mostly young, we tell them not to make sports for 1 or 2 years. But actually, we don't really know. How to discriminate patients who will have the disease again from the other. So it's not really scientific, but it's we do it for all patients, and we don't really know which one it's useful. And the colchicine, it's for antiarrhythmic treatment. So I wanted to present you some classification of the myocarditis. There are many who exist. So the fulminant, you see, if it's fulminant, there is a high death rate or transplantation or heart transplantation of 50%. And and there are another form, which is histological. You see the blue curve. If you have a big cells myocarditis, you will die in 80% case. And another classification, which is about the imaging. If you have a late enhancement of your body at the MRI, it will be bad for you. It will be bad for you. So the challenges of the prognosis is to try to estimate the risk for a patient to have a serious cardiological event, considering only the data we have at the arrival of the patient. So it was our goals to develop a tool for stratifying the risk of serious events using only the admission data. For that, we use a Bayesian approach and a regression approach. Stéphane, you asked the first day if there were environment who liked to make regression, and medicine is one. So it was important for them to make a regression tool and to compare the two models. So, considering our population, we have 359 patients who have been hospitalized for acute myocarditis at the Heart Institute at La Pitié-Salpêtrière between 208 and 219. The data comes from their medical file, which contains clinical, biological, radiological, histological, and immunological data, and the follow-up is done using the medical file, some standardized telephone questionnaire, and the vital statue was found using the civil statue or calling their doctors. So to be included in this study, the patient have to first add to have a clinically suspected myocarditis. So it consists in chest pain, dyspnea, fatigue, heart failure, or palpitations, syncope, sudden death, unexplained cardiogenic shock. So if you know a little about infarctus, it really looks like it. And a diagnostic criterion, like a new electrical anomaly at the electrocardiogram, and a troponin elevation, and a new functional and structural anomaly of the heart at the imaging. And the patient had to have a proof of the myocarditis. The proof could be the MRI with an edema, like I show you earlier, and the late enhancement, or it could be a biopsy. But looking at the data, biopsy were mostly done in the patient who died or in the patient who had a heart transplant. So I did not use it for the models, because it's too correlated with death, and I can't predict anything with it. And to exclude our patient, it was when they had a confusing cardiac cause, like a valve disease, a congenital heart disease, and a history of heart transplantation, and coronary artery disease explaining the clinical presentation. So we don't want them to have an infarctus. We want them to have a myocarditis. The composite, so for our model, we have built composite outcome with the death from any cause, the temporary circulatory assistance, which is a mechanical support of the heart by extracorporeal membrane oxygenation, or IMPELA, which are you take the blood, you oxygenize it out of the body, and you put it again in the body. And the IMPELA is a motor, not a long-term treatment, but it can help you to to survive for some time. But it's not a robot heart, but and a heart transplant. So basically, our composite outcome is consists in death without high intensive care. So we have our two models. First, I will present the Bayesian and then the regression. So the Bayesian, we had our 200 variables, and with our expert knowledge, we only took 50 variables of interest, and we only keeps baseline variables, and we took off the variables of the follow-up. We discretized the continuous variable with threshold of interest or using RGNAP for some variables. And for learning the model, we used the Markov blanket algorithm. And then for the regression, we took the same 50 variables, and we only keep the one with the consistent odd ratio. And then we had 27 variables, and we made a step-by-step backward regression. So at the end of the day, we had a multivariate model of 7 variables. So that's the table of our database. It's in French, sorry, I didn't translate it, but you see there are a lot of men, and they were pretty young. If you have questions about it, I can go back later. But okay. And considering our outcome, you see we had 67 patients who had our composite outcome, and 54 who had a temporary mechanical support. So basically, it could be our outcome. It's almost all patients who died, or all patients who had a heart transplantation, had a mechanical support. So our regression, we only had 7 variables, like the sex, which is protector when you're a man, and the ejection fraction of the left ventricle, which is which strong is your heart, which how much blood your heart can send to your artery, and there is also the cancer and the cardiogenic shock, which are the stronger variables of our models. So we attribute a not for all of these characteristics, it was a simple addition that we made for all of our patients. And then we have a score for a not for all of these patients, and we can obtain a rock curve with an area under the curve of 0.92. So that's good. And with an internal validation in 10 intervals, it was the same. It was a 0.91 area under the curve. Okay, so now you see the notes for all of our patients, considering they have the outcome or not. And you see there is a threshold at 4 that we can take to classify our patient. Do we want to be very prudent with them like this, or it's okay, they will be going well here? And then we We made three classes for our patients. There are the survival curves for all of these classes. So you see there is a high risk patient classes with a score superior to 4. We can think to send this patient in intensive care directly at their arrival. Near to it, we have two other classes. So there is a medium risk patient classes with a score between 2 and 4. And we can imagine to hospitalize them in a classical cardiology call service, but near an intensive care service. And then there is the low risk patients class, and we can imagine to hospitalize them in a cardiological service. Not necessarily near an intensive care service. So that's for the characteristics of the patients, those who have the outcome and not. So the red ones, this is the mean value of all the variables. So you see they are really in a cardiogenic shock. They have more syncope, more cancer. They are mostly women with a high left ventricular ejection fraction and a conduction disorder of the heart. So it can be useful to characterize both typical patients. And the patient who is going well, it's mostly a man with a high left ventricular ejection fraction and no shock, no syncope, no cancer, and no conduction disorder. Now, the Bayesian model. So we use the Markov-Blanket algorithm, and we had six variables this time. You see the cardiogenic shock and the sex, but all the other variables are different. So there is the NT-proBNP, the chest pain, the creatinine, and the TP, and the prothrombin rate, sorry, in English. So this model is interesting because I think it's very clinically insightful. The NT-proBNP is a marker for heart pain, and when you have a lot of it, it's really bad for you because your heart is suffering. The chest pain is a protector, and when we click on yes, it's it lowers the probability to have the outcome. And the creatinine is show us that the impact on the kidney when it's superior to 100, it's bad for the patient. And the prothrombin type sees the state of the liver. So the liver and the kidney are both organs who suffers from a heart failure. So that's nice to have them in the model. And the sex who is a protector, the same way that in the regression. And we have the yes. Okay, and we have an area under the curve of 0.91, which is pretty much the same of the other. So we have the same performances using different variables, which is really interesting. Now, if you see the histogram of the Bayesian score for patients, you see, it's really send the note to zero or to one, and letting almost no patient between zero and one. So there is a threshold that we can take at 0.055 to make our threshold and to make our classes of patients. So the same way we make earlier, we created three classes of patients: low risk, medium risk, and high risk patients. So, but with different threshold, we can take superior to 50% and between 5 and 50%. Okay. Now you see the online simulator for our model. We can share it with other center, which is good for the patient eventually. And now you see the radar chart, the similar one, but with this variable. So our patient which have the outcome have a lot of cardiogenic shock, a high anti-proBNP, less chest pain, less a little prothrombin rate, and high creatinine, and they are mostly women, the same as earlier. So the limits of our study was that it was monocentric, so it's only at the Heart Institute of La Pitié-Salpêtrière. And the way of doing medicine can be different considering the center. For example, there is an Italian doctor which makes less mechanical support than us. So it's a limit of our study. It can be difficult to use this score considering the way of doing medicine of other centers. It's also a 12 years period study, so the diagnostic and therapeutic is in development. It's not the same as in 208. It can be a limit to use data from 12 years ago to estimate the prognosis of a patient today. We have also the imputation of missing data, which is not it's not due. I didn't do it in Bayesian lab, but I had to do it in a regression because you need no missing value to make the regression. So I imputate with the medians, which is not the nicest way to do it, but that's it. And we really need an external validation to validate our both model. And in conclusion, both models are clinically insightful, which is beautiful considering there are different variables, but both models is good using different variables. We can say to explain this that the discretization is not the same. The regression uses the time to event and not the Bayesian approach. The Bayesian network is able to include variables with missing value. And for further development, we can imagine to analyze a combined prediction of the two models to be better. And we can adjust a Bayesian network with variables selected by the regression to try if it works well. And of course, we have to make an external validation. Thank you for your attention, and thank you.